Hey, what's going on, my beautiful people? Another great day here inside the Black Actors Studio. I'm your host, Danny Royce, and joining me today is an incredibly talented actress and all-around performer. You've seen her recently in Fox's Empire and Tales. She's also in stars in BET's The Bobby DeBarge Story. Don't move a muscle.
Tuned into Black Hollywood Live, the world's first digital broadcast network devoted entirely to urban entertainment and pop culture. Tune in right now.
Hey, what's good? Welcome inside the Black Actors Studio. My guest today, her career spans over three decades. You cannot talk about black film without mentioning her name. She's been in White Men Can't Jump, Boyz N The Hood, Jungle Fever, and many, many more. Please welcome, the Black Actors Studio is very proud to have Miss Tyra Ferrell.
Oh,
how you doing?
Thank you. I'm honored to be here. Thank you very much.
It's great to have you. Longtime fan.
Thank you.
Love your work. And I just want to start off by saying the Bobby DeBarge story, right?
Mm.
You play the mother.
Yes.
So how was getting that role?
Well, lately, the things you've seen me in have all been offers.
Mm-hmm.
And you always want an offer, because when someone offers you a role, that means they understand what you bring to the project.
Right.
And so it was an offer that I could not resist or refuse. So I was more than happy to accept it once I read the script.
Awesome. Mm-hmm. All right, well, we're going to talk about that a little bit later mm-hmm. as well. But I like to start from the beginning.
Okay.
Where were you born?
I was born in Houston, Texas.
Houston, Texas.
And raised, and went to University of Texas in Austin. But
right.
before there, I went to a small junior college called Lon Morris Junior College. So,
wow.
I was born and raised in Houston.
Nice. And so, what was your father's profession?
My father, I had a stepfather. Mm-hmm. My biological father was not in my life, but I knew who he was. But my stepfather was a bus driver, which was a very prestigious job back then.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
All right.
Bus drivers and African-American
yeah.
men driving the bus. And,
yeah.
And so that's what he did. And my mother had her own catering business.
Really? Nice.
But she also, I used to think I was a little rich kid, but she said, no, I worked three jobs. But she and my father were together from the time that I was a little girl mm-hmm. in elementary school, about third grade until I was about to graduate from high school.
Okay.
But then they divorced, and so my mom, but she was really hands-on. She raised all of us.
Yeah.
There were five of us.
Five of you. Mm-hmm. Wow.
I was the second oldest.
The second oldest?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
I was next to the oldest.
And so your mom, she was very encouraging, right? Because she gave you, like, the blessing to go ahead and just do this.
Yeah, well, it was difficult at first. She said, how is a little girl here in Houston going to make it all the way to Hollywood, you know? But with the catering business, I worked with her, but I hated serving people. I hated the whole cooking. I don't like to cook. I just didn't like it, and I wasn't very good at it. And so she said, well, this is what I love to do, and this is what makes our lives, pays for our lives and
right.
make it very comfortable for you. So what you need to do is find what you love and go and make it happen for yourself. So she was very encouraging once I decided, but she didn't like the idea about Hollywood. But I told her, I said, Ma, I know what I'm doing. I went to the High School of Performing Arts
mm-hmm.
in Houston, Texas.
Right.
That means I was the third in the nation at the time.
Yeah.
And so when I auditioned for it, I was accepted in dance, music, and acting. And then, so when she saw me in those productions, she saw something there, and she says, okay, I think you can do this.
Yeah. So now, yeah, you have my approval now.
Yeah.
What was it that pulled you to performing?
Well, when I was in what they call middle school now, junior mm-hmm. high, I wanted to be a cheerleader.
Mm-hmm.
And I made C's. And my dad said, nope, no cheerleader has to make A's all
yeah.
the way or B's. Or if you can't make A's and B's, then you can't be a cheerleader. So then I said, well, okay, I'll go to the, they had something called the drama department. So I said, you know, I'll make that C and go to the drama department. And, and when I got into the drama department, the speech teacher said, ooh, your voice. You have a nice voice. Mm-hmm. Why don't you read? Let's do speech tournaments. And I would win awards in doing drama interpretations or things nice. Like that. And so I got the bug there. And she said, you could be the next Betty Davis. And I thought, really? So what she did was, when I was about to graduate, she saw that the High School of Performing Arts was going to come to Houston, and she helped me to go in and audition, and I got in. And after that, because I was a little wild child, and so once I found what I loved to do, it was everything.
That's
so
awesome.
Going there, and that's what started it all.
That's great. Mm-hmm. Wow. So growing up, did you see anyone on TV that you just was like, oh my God, I want to do that? Any shows, anything like that you were really a fan of?
Well, yeah, I liked old black and white movies. Mm. I really did. I remember seeing Diana Ross, mm-hmm. and seeing her in Lady Sings the Blues, and that moved me.
Nice.
She's a Aries, and so am I.
Nice.
And she had a lot of power, and she moved me. Mm-hmm. But also, I watched a lot of black and white films with Joan Crawford, Betty Davis, and very powerful women who were in control, who didn't necessarily look like your typical beauty, but they had the power which made them beautiful.
Right.
So I would watch movies a lot and mm-hmm. just daydream about that, but I never saw myself. So I decided I wanted to do that once I went to the High School of Performing Arts and did the training for character study and Ibsen and Shakespeare and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, yeah. Cool. Yeah. So when you, as a black woman at that time, mm-hmm. You know, you didn't see a lot of yourself on the screen.
Right.
And so did that ever discourage you from pushing forward and pursuing this?
No, never, because when I went to the High School of Performing Arts, my teachers, they really saw something in me. Mm. And then when you study acting, you learn how to develop a character, character study, thought divisions, you know, making it all technical, but then breathing it in and making it natural.
Right.
So I just got the bug, and I was, you know, I would audition locally in Houston and get things. So, and I also, for summer jobs, I would sing and dance for Six Flags over Texas.
Nice.
So that paid quite a bit of money for a young girl at that age. Mm-hmm. So musical comedy was one of my favorite things to do as well.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Great.
So no, I was not discouraged. I felt very special. I felt like, you know, I felt like I was always a token. I mean, that's what they say. Sometimes you're the only black one in it, you know, so I knew how to embrace that and use it.
Awesome, and use it for power.
Yeah, or just to use it for my instrument until I got to a place where I wasn't the only one.
Awesome, great. And so when you were in, you did quite a bit of like off-Broadway and music theater and all
mm-hmm.
that.
Mm-hmm.
Elia Kazan, the director of On the Waterfront,
mm-hmm.
tell
mm-hmm.
us about that that experience.
Well, that happened at the High School of Performing Arts mm-hmm. because we were fortunate enough at the High School of Performing Arts that they would always bring in people from New York and to work with us and study, so we could study with them and see what the techniques were. And I was in with a crowd of people, and I was chosen to go on stage to do an exercise. And after I did a couple of exercises, he turned to me and said, "You belong in New York." He says to me, "I know you want to pursue this," he says, "but don't go to Hollywood first. Go to New York.
Mm.
You know, do that work first because you have what it takes." And he gave me his name and phone number and told me if I ever needed any help to give him a call.
That's awesome.
But I never did.
You never did?
No, I never did. I never did.
Wow. And so in theater, so you're in New York, right? And you performed a lot. You did a lot of shows, Dream Girls. Girls, things like that.
Yes, yes.
And so you met Lena Horne. Mm-hmm. You danced with Lena Horne. So mm-hmm. that's mm-hmm. incredible right there. So tell us about that experience.
Yeah. When I first went to New York, I was discovered at the University of Texas in Austin. I did a Shakespearean play called The Merchant of Venice. And mm-hmm. I played Portia. She's the queen, and she had her own servants and everything. And this director, who years ago, you're too young to know, I was too young to know about it, but he he was a director and a producer over a show called The Hit Parade, where you have people like Lola Falana, you know, all of the dancers. It was just a real famous show at the time. Well, his agent would get him summer jobs to go to universities and direct musicals. So he came, and I knew he was going to be there, but I knew I was going to Six Flags over New Jersey so I could get closer to New York because I was graduating from college at the time. Mm-hmm. So when I went to see him, I went early again. I always go early. I go an hour early to check out the scene. There was this gray-haired man standing at the door, and he let me in because it was locked. And he says, "Who are you and what are you looking for?" I said, "There's a big deal producer here, and I'm coming to meet him because I'm going to be a star." And he says, "Really?" He says, "Well, I'm that producer." And he says, "You're going to be a star?" He goes, "Be careful saying you're going to be a star." He says, "You have to define that, because you could be a star doing anything. You could be a star doing a commercial. You can be a star of something negative. So define the kind of star you want to be." He says, "But come on in the back. It's just you and I. Sing and dance for me. See what you got."
Wow.
So I sang for him and I danced for him, and I said, "Come see me tonight. I'm performing as Portia in The Merchant of Venice in this major production." So he did come, and when it was over, he came to me and says, "I need to talk to your mom. You do not need to be in Texas. I will help you, set you up, do everything I can, and secure your future. Just come to New York. I'll take care of you."
Wow.
And in the best way possible. He set me up at the Barbizon Hotel for Women, where Carol Burnett and models and famous people stayed to be safe in their early careers. And I went there, and I think that was the last year it existed. And he set me up with four agents. All of them wanted me, and that's when all the musicals, Sophisticated Ladies, Ain't Misbehaving, Bubbling Brown Sugar, all of that was going on.
Wow.
And so I chose my agent because Christopher Reeves, the real Superman, came out of the room. And when I went into this particular agent's office, he says, he was the only one who said, "So what do you want to do with your life and your career?" And that's the agent I chose because I wanted to be an actress. I didn't want to be a singer and a dancer.
Gotcha.
But I could
what
do
you could
all
do. Yeah, for sure. I like how you said the real Superman.
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
Because he will always be the real
Christopher
Superman.
Christopher Reeves, yes,
to me
yes.
As well.
May he rest in peace.
Right,
yes.
Rest in peace. Mm-hmm. And so you also met Cicely Tyson, which I had the privilege of listening to her speak at St. Sabina Church in Chicago, which was amazing. So how was that empowering for you? Because I know it was an incredible moment.
Yeah, well, it was opening night of Lena Horne, The Lady and Her Music on Broadway, and she came, and she was gorgeous, and doing the Broadway show, you got to see all kinds of stars. Sammy Davis Jr., Paul Newman, you name them, they would come to see Lena. And in seeing Lena, they would see me.
Of course.
And sometimes they'd say, "Where's the young lady with the back muscles?" You know what I mean? But I would get in trouble sometimes on stage because I shine too much. So, that's a problem. that's another story.
Right, right. Well, I mean, now that you said that, I mean, speak about that a little bit. Like, because some people have to so-called dim their light a little bit.
Exactly.
So, yeah, speaking about that.
Well, that did happen to me. I mean, I love Lena Horne. I mean, when I went in for the audition, I went early, and I was straight out. I wore this real Southern Belle sort of dress. It had a petticoat under it, and I had my big afro at the time as well. And I went in, and I went early, and I would see, and in walked the musical director, and he says, "What are you doing here so early?" I said, "I always come early." He says, "Okay, come in, let's play." So we went into the room, and I sang. He says, "What are you going to sing for me?" I said, "Summertime," because it was a song that my mom used to sing to me as a little girl.
Right.
So I sang "Summertime," and I have a very big, wide octave, as they say. And so he said, "Whoa, that was beautiful." He goes, "Try this." And he'd hit notes, and I'd hit every note. So
nice.
We had a great time collaborating and playing, and he said, "Listen, I'm going to let you go. I want you to meet Lena. I have to see a lot of other girls, but I think you have the part." So I did meet Lena, and I got the role. Now, when the show opened, opening night, it's sad to say, I got word from the producers. They said, I'm going to be brutally honest here. He said, they came backstage, and they said, "Tyra, this is straight from the lady, tone down 75%.
Oh.
Not 10, not 15, 75.
Wow.
And I said, "Are you kidding me?"
Wow.
I said, "I was trained to sing to the balcony. Bring it down." So then I'd have to bring it down because, and I get it.
Yeah.
You know, she's a star, and you have this butterfly fluttering around you, getting in the way. I totally got it.
Right.
So you hit it on the head about toning down and dimming your light. But I just knew that that was an experience. So as I grew older, I had to learn from that experience. When you go into a room, you have to case it out. There are women, you give them respect. Yeah. You give the men respect. Yeah. Everyone gets respect. There's a technique to auditioning, and there's a technique to the work itself.
Right.
Yeah. But Elena was a wonderful person and a performer, but I had a little bit too much shine at that time.
Bring it down a little bit.
Bring it down. But I was trained to do that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, trained to just give all of you.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Because it was a theater. It was huge.
Right.
Exactly. To the balcony.
To the balcony, right.
Yeah.
So we're here, and when did you come out to L.A., to Hollywood?
I was in New York for about 6 years, mm-hmm. and I couldn't get arrested. I was trying all kinds of shows, and then Dreamgirls came up.
Yeah.
It was already on Broadway, but they needed the L.A. company at the Schubert Theater mm-hmm. in Century City. So they had auditions for everyone, so I went in for that, and I got a chorus role. I was called the stepsister, which is basically the chorus, mm-hmm. and I got that role, and that took me to L.A. And mm-hmm. when it was there, I decided it was there for like 9 months to a year,
yeah.
and when it ended, that whole cast was going to go on the road. And I decided I didn't want to go on the road. All the awards had been won. And so I wanted to stay and hone in on the camera since Dreamgirls took me to L.A.
Right.
I'm an actress. I'm studied. No more singing and dancing.
Right.
Now it's time to hone in on the camera.
Nice.
And that's another whole technique.
Yes, it is.
So that's what took me there in 83, I think it was. And it was wonderful. So when the show left, I said, no, I'm staying.
Wow.
And I'm going to beat the pavement the way a lot of us do when we first start off in the industry.
For sure.
Acting.
And you honed in on that screen because, man, like, school days, Jungle Fever, White Man Can't Jump, Poetic Justice, oh my God. Like, there's so many. So many classics, which I want to touch on. Working with, for one, tell us about your first big role.
Okay.
Just tell us about your first big role and how that started everything else.
Right. Well, there were a lot in between before that happened.
For
you
sure.
know, Hill Street Blues, episodic mm-hmm. things. I did a lot, but the first big role. Let's see. What was big? Boyz N The Hood was the biggest.
That was huge.
Boyz N The Hood. But I got Boyz N The Hood and Jungle Fever at the same time.
At the same time.
So I did, like I say, I'm going to get the months wrong, but I say November or October, I did Jungle Fever. I got that role. And that was an audition in itself. And then I got, the next month, I went to do Boyz N The Hood. Mm. So they were back to back. And I wanted it because I wanted to show that I was a character actress because it was Jungle Fever, and she was a nice, educated,
yeah.
you know, middle-class girl. Mm-hmm. And then Miss Baker was totally the
totally
opposite.
Different.
So I had to have it because I wanted to prove to Hollywood that I wasn't just one note.
Right.
I wasn't a personality. I had depth, and I studied character development. So those were the two roles. And what's funny is when I was doing Jungle Fever, having a great time with Spike and the cast and John Turturro, I would pick up the script of Boys, and I would get nauseous because I don't multitask well, and I wasn't ready to take that on, so it would throw my equilibrium off sometimes because I'm that sort of actress. I don't multitask well.
Right, right.
I'm in the moment, and that's everything.
Gotcha.
And so those two, the auditioning process was a lot of fun, and I got the roles, and that just started everything.
Yeah. So how was it, because you were working, I mean, you did both of them? Were you filming both of them at the same time?
Yeah, meaning like, say like October, I did Jungle Fever.
Mm-hmm.
And then November, I went and did Boys.
Boys, okay.
So it was like one after the
one
other.
One after the other.
Immediately.
Wow.
But I had both scripts in the hotel.
Wow.
So I couldn't read that one, though.
Right, put that one off to
it. Yeah.
How was it working with Spike Lee and that just being directed by him and just being on the set?
It was wonderful.
Yeah.
Robbie Reed was the casting director, mm-hmm. and she, up to that point, she had been sending me out on different things, you know, episodics. And I went in and I met Spike at Chateau Marmont. Mm. That's where we were holding auditions. And it was a really good rapport.
Yeah.
I was real natural and just kept it real.
Right.
That's what I like to do, keeping it real in the moment and feeling. And And so that was great, and I got the role.
Nice.
That was nice.
And
Spike was wonderful. He listened because I like to collaborate. I just don't say do me.
You know, right. Like,
I here I am. You know, I have ideas about my character.
That's awesome.
Everything, the purse on the shoulder, everything is technical and things like that.
When I asked you mentioned that, so how important do you feel as actors to really own their character and own themselves?
Oh, it's really important because. It's about becoming that character. It's about understanding who she is. Mm-hmm. And it's a physical thing. I just go inside and find out who I am within that role, mm-hmm. and what experiences I've had and right. what voice she has.
Right.
Know? So
that's awesome.
It's a good time.
It is. Yeah, it's fun. It's really fun. And so did you go see Black Klansman, or did you see that film?
Well, I have to be perfectly honest with you. You know, I've been gone for like 27
right.
years.
Mm-hmm.
And in that time, I haven't seen anything.
Oh, well, okay.
Sorry to say.
Oh, I mean.
I've been so busy.
You've been doing a lot, which we'll get into. Yeah.
A lot of work with my husband and being a housewife. When I left Hollywood, I hopped on a motorcycle and I left and I never came back.
That's
and
crazy.
And I sometimes when the work which we'll talk about mm-hmm. I do with my husband, it's so serious and intense, and it's that watching TV and episodics doesn't move me at all mm-hmm. at that time, you know what I mean?
Right.
I couldn't feel it. I'm into politics a lot, you know, what was going on, and being mother, digging in the garden and raising my daughter and supporting my husband and doing our work. So I really left, and so I haven't seen anything in a very long time.
In a very long time.
Yeah.
And so John Singleton, again, an amazing black director, mm-hmm. So many credits on it as well. How was it working with him and the whole cast and Poetic Justice and Boyz in the Hood? Mm. Boyz in the Hood is, I mean, I'll keep beating it, but it's a classic, and it taught so many young black people, men and women, mm-hmm. Just that were in the struggle and that could relate to mm-hmm. everything that's happened on screen.
Mm-hmm.
It just showed them how to overcome it and empower, and your character is just amazing.
Yeah. Well, meeting John Singleton was everything. I'm about collaborating. And mm-hmm. when I met him, I had ideas about the character, but I auditioned. The screen test is really frightening to see because the phone rang while I was, you know, in the middle of my scene, and I turn and told my child to pick up, answer that phone, that, you know, so I used the moment.
Yes,
you know, I was
instinctive
to,
nice.
You know, like if a plate falls, you don't ignore it, you go for it.
Right.
But John was very helpful, and it was just great. He understood. He says, and then he said to me, you know, you're so beautiful and you're mm-hmm. sexy, and I never see your sexiness. He goes, I'm going to write a role for you. So he wrote Poetic Justice not only for Janet, but he had me in mind when he wrote it for Jesse. But I remember going away from Boyz in the Hood and having to come back to Loop, and I was doing Equinox, an independent film, and he said to me, and he says, Tyra, I want you to get them drive-by shooters. And I said, oh, that's so hostile. He goes, listen, you are no longer Tyra Ferrell. You are Miss Baker. Mm. Snap out of it and get back in it. And I was like, oh, yeah, that's right. I had to be reminded because I did it. I moved on from it.
Right.
And so...
Right.
That's what happened.
Poetic Justice is amazing.
But John was he loved to collaborate. Mm-hmm. We talk, have ideas, and that's what I loved about acting.
That's good.
And he directed me and said, a little bit more of this, a little less of that.
Gotcha.
What have you.
Okay, and then you also worked with Denzel, the Mighty Quinn.
Mm-hmm.
Give how was that experience working with Denzel Washington?
Well, you know, to me, we're all actors. I don't look up to anyone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, once I get him, it was great. It was Denzel Washington. Yeah, but I'm Tyra Ferrell.
Yeah.
Whether I had done anything or not, it was about us
dancing,
you know, dancing together in this role. And I was very pleased. But what happened to me with that role is I was told, Tyra, you're falling between the cracks. You're gonna hear about this role, but you're not gonna get it. So, and then I found out all my friends were going in it who were just like me. So I was furious about it. So I said, get me an audition. And I fought to get into the room, and they had a lot of pretty girls going in. So I did audition for it, and I remember the audition very well. I heard the girl before me. She was doing all kinds of yelling and bouncing off the wall, and I was like, oh no, I'm not gonna do that. I guess I'm not gonna get it. But I went in and I sat really close to the casting director, and I said, you want, let's do it like this. And she said, okay. And I did the scene, and when it was over, she didn't work with me. She goes, thank you very much. So I left, and I said, oh my God, I beat my agents up to get me in, and I guess I didn't get it, but I got a call and I got a screen test.
Nice.
Because, you know, I did it my way. Regardless, you can be intimidated in those auditioning rooms, you know, but you still have to hold on to who you are and what you do. Your authenticity is very important. So working with Denzel, I made him catch me and struggle with me. I pulled him in the water. I had a great time. Catch me if you can, because I was serious about it. Yeah. And I don't. So it was a good time.
That's great. That's awesome. And then White Men Can't Jump. Working with Wesley Snipes, Woody Harrelson. Tell us a little bit about that role and how you prepared for that.
Well, that's a great story, because it's the audition in itself that I think made the difference. I was very insecure. I knew I didn't think I was that pretty. I thought, but I had just finished.
Gorgeous, looking at.
Anyway, I had so I went in and met with Ron Shelton, but he had just done Bull Durham, and I loved the Susan Sarandon role, because it was a woman who was in charge and she was sexy. And so when I went in for the audition, we talked. You know, that's what's missing today. Today they're putting themselves on tape, you know, taping yourself.
Yeah.
But for me, going in that room, being able to sit and talk and collaborate, and so they could feel me, feel you know, how human I am, how I can relate.
Right.
So that's what used to work for me. And we talked about politics, and we shared this book, content of our character. So then after he says, are you ready to do this audition? I said, yeah. So I always hold the audition in a place in my mind and in my head. So after they say, okay, let's do it, after we do all this conversing, and then I did the work, and when it was over, he said, okay, thank you very much. But I ran home. I bought the book that he brought up called The Content of Our Character by Shelby Steele.
Oh, wow,
I read it. And so when I went back to the callback, I said, I read that book. He goes, so what did you think? And I told him what I thought, and he was surprised, because he liked the book, and I told him what was wrong with the book, because it was an African-American author. And he said, really, Tyra, I never saw that spin on it. I said, that's how I feel. And after that, he called me back to work with Wesley, and I said to him, before I had to one-on-one with Wesley, I said, listen, you may not choose me as this actress for the role, but please choose a sister of color who has dark skin, full lips, and a nose like mine, because there's so many of us brown sisters out there who are not being represented. Our brothers, and Wesley had just left Jungle Fever with the, you know, beautiful Lonette McKee, and she's lovely, of course. And then he was with the, you know, the white girl. And so he needed a sister.
Yes.
So, because we sisters wanted to be represented.
Right.
And I just said, we sisters need to see our brothers loving on us. So I said, if you don't choose me, at least choose some sister with some color.
Mm-hmm.
And then I had a reading with Wesley, and I threw a chair across the room. I had fun. I sat on his lap.
Nice.
And it was really nice. It was magical.
That's great.
So I got the role.
Needless to say, you got the role. Did you ever hear about the parody that excuse me, that was inspired by Boyz N The Hood? Don't be a menace to South Central while drinking a juice in the hood by the Wayans brothers.
Oh, no.
No, okay. Well, I was going to say, because your role literally started that whole film.
Really?
Yes, the parody. You got to check it out.
I didn't see the parody.
Yeah, it's pretty funny. it was done like in the early 2000s, but yeah.
It's hard to make me laugh.
Is it?
Yeah. I, it's hard.
Yeah.
Especially when we make fun of each other. But I get it.
Yeah,
get it.
You get it. Yeah.
I get it.
But yeah, it's just interesting how that role from Boyz N The Hood really
inspired
that.
What's the name of it?
It's The Longest title in of in film.
Okay.
Don't be a menace to South Central while drinking your juice in the hood.
Oh. All right.
It's yeah, Wayne's brothers.
I mean, is his sister in it?
Yeah.
Because I get she I get
plays,
her a lot.
Yeah. Okay. She plays
okay.
you.
Okay. I believe it. She's yeah. she's lovely. She's yeah. lovely. We're from the same tribe.
There you go.
Yeah.
So during your rise here in Hollywood, right? Mm-hmm. You have all these things going on for you. Were there ever like anything, any personal demons or challenges that would try to hold you from doing what you wanted to do?
No. I'm a loner. Mm. And I spend a lot of time alone, even as a kid. Mm. And I am my best friend.
Yeah.
The mirror is my best friend. Yeah. And the only thing is, like, I would say 98% of it, the auditioning was no. But that 2% was mine, mm. you know. And it's strong and it's powerful because you're talking about these roles, even the episodic little things coming up there. Yeah. But no demons. The only okay. demon, you have to be careful, it can be yourself.
Right.
What you think of yourself, what you think of the industry. What I did have to do, though, I had to stop reading the newspapers and biographies of mm. Angela and Malcolm because I was angry. So I had to put that down. So when I walk in the room, my aura was not about anger.
Yeah.
It was about just peace. And let's see what we can make happen in this room.
Nice. Yeah, well, you always been like very secure within yourself and know
oh, yes.
who you are,
yeah.
which I think is very important. You know, especially in Hollywood.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, I want to talk about you left, when you left Hollywood.
Yes.
And you went on the bike and you went to New York. Mm-hmm. Any regrets about stepping away?
Listen, I got to the very top. Yeah. I was there with who's who right now.
Yeah.
We were there together.
You were.
And I had a choice. It was career or love. Mm. And I chose love. Because I met a man who is incredible, he's a genius, he's the most powerful and kind person I've ever known. And when a man loves a woman, that's real.
Yeah.
And he loves me, and I've never felt love like this before.
Wow.
And he understood my muscles and my mouth and my arms and my six-pack. He loved me because I was political, and we talked politics all the time, and we talked life. So the moment we met, you know, we never separated, and I chose love, and I said, hey, I'm going to do it like the white girls. Send me the script. I'll read it and decide if I want to do it.
Hey,
so
there you go.
For our honeymoon, I bought us a beautiful Goldwing, where it's a big bike, a Honda Goldwing, and we drove from Los Angeles to New York and
wow.
ended up in Pennsylvania because he was working on his master's and PhD.
Wow.
And that we took a month to do it.
Wow.
And we did a lot of civil rights work while
yeah.
we were going through the South and everything,
mm-hmm.
collecting information, videotaping things that we saw. So I chose love. And I'll tell you, we've been married 27 years on April 9th
wow.
coming up. And I have to tell you, I haven't regretted it once because the work that we're doing is so fulfilling.
Mm-hmm.
And also, now that my daughter is situated and the marriage is strong, and the business is going well, it's time to get back to me. Who am I? What can I do? Because I have about maybe 15, 20 more years to give up myself in this business, and it's like riding the bike. I've been reading scripts, and the language jumps inside of me.
Mm.
You know what you can and want to do.
Right, right. Wow. And so your husband does a lot of police brutality and stuff
yes.
like that, right? And you get in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, speak a little bit about that.
My husband was a police officer.
Mm-hmm.
He was Sergeant Don Jackson.
Mm-hmm.
And he changed legislature in
wow.
Los Angeles, where all cops have to do sensitivity training.
Wow.
My husband went undercover as a black man. As a police officer, because his father was a cop. His
mm-hmm.
father was a one of the first police officers back in the 50s, and he wanted to be like his dad, a good cop. But then one day, his dad was pulled over by the cops and was beat savagely, and they were looking for a 25-year-old. But we have a business called policeabuse.com. You can go online and you can see his biography and everything, because I know we don't have a lot of time. But just know that he went undercover, and he bust bad cops. And what he did was he called NBC, and right before the Rodney King case, my husband went undercover, and his head went through the cops pulled him over, profiling him,
mm-hmm.
pulled him out of the car, and put his head through a plate glass window, and all the glass shattered.
Wow.
But he wasn't harmed at all. He's doing God's work.
Yeah.
And we both are. And he needed us. I saw him on TV on one of these 60-minute shows, and I wrote his name on my affirmation wall and said, this man needs a strong woman. He needs support. And little did I know, he came to me at a Hollywood party and tapped me on my shoulder and said, ooh, who are you? And it was him.
Wow.
So, and I met him the same week I met Mandela.
Yes.
So it's a wonderful story. Yeah. I love him. And Hollywood's right now working on telling our life story. So.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Awesome.
So I'm excited about
that. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you met Nelson Mandela, another amazing figure. Wow. What's that experience like?
Well, I like I said, I've always been political. When I would work out, I would sweat and I would meditate on freedom because people said, you'll never see Mandela free. And never tell me never. Mm. So my prayers, and I joined an organization called Artist for Free South Africa. Mm-hmm. And I became part of that. And I went to the events that they had, and when he was set free, I was a struggling actress at that time, and I had $1,000, but I've never had any other job, but I saved my money. Mm. And you save your money, but you're still broke, you know? So that, you know. But I bought this $1,000 ticket, and I went, and Marla Gibbs was there, Diana Ross was there,
wow.
Jane Fonda, and I just had a ticket, but I decided to go to the restroom, and when I went to the restroom, the door was open, and there was this big wooden door, and I just said, what's in there? And I went into that room, and the doors closed behind me, and that was the room for the celebrities, and out walked Mandela.
Mm.
And I was like, someone, and I could tell people looked at me, it's like, you're not supposed to be here, but they didn't know my relationship with God in the prayers and the meditation and the poems that I wrote about him. And when I would work out, I would sweat and visualize his freedom. So
wow.
I walked up straight to him and I shook his hand, and he shook my hand and I kissed his hand. And when he was there, it was a very wonderful experience.
Wow.
Because I got to meet the man that I was meditating and praying on for so
right.
long. And then that same weekend, I met my husband, who I had seen and written on my affirmation wall that he needed
crazy.
A strong woman.
Look at that. And I can see, like, just, you know, going through that as you're telling it again. Like,
yeah.
that's magical and incredible.
Yeah.
Okay, so you made your comeback, and you're on Empire.
Yeah.
So how was that working on Empire with Lee Daniels and, like... And that, and you're in the FBI too, so.
yeah. Well, I had never seen the show, but
yeah.
I have a best friend in Houston, Texas. When I would go home, I always go home, and her name is Jackie. And she said, "Tyra, you have to watch this show." And I go, "Oh, I don't watch TV." She goes, "Please." She sat me down. She made me watch Empire, and I was like, "Whoa, this show is great!
Right?
It's hip hop. It's music. It's sexy. I love it."
Mm-hmm.
And so she goes, "Yeah, you should get on it." I'm going, "Yeah." So then, but I have this friend Tasha Smith. She had put me in one of her independent films that she wrote about bipolar in the African American community.
Mm-hmm.
And when I did it for her, I said, look, I can't do it until I read it. And when I read it, it was a lovely piece.
Mm.
It was very political in its own way, introducing bipolar. We call each other crazy, but
right.
we shouldn't do that. We
right.
have issues. So after I did that, Lee is very close to Tasha.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, how did you get Tyra Ferrell? She says, she's a friend of mine. He says, I'm going to offer her a role on this. So he called me and we Skyped.
Yeah.
And he says, will you do it? I said, I would be honored. And so I did that, and that's what got me back into the industry.
Nice.
And so, and it was an offer.
Yes.
I love offers.
You gotta love offers.
Give me an offer, baby.
And so...
So it was wonderful working with Lee and Taraji.
Yeah, Taraji.
She is just action and
right.
movement and beauty and Terrence Howard and Jesse Smollett and Gabby were so giving and loving, and they just made me feel like family. They appreciated me, and
mm-hmm.
I had no idea why until Gabby made me go get an Instagram, and then when I got it, all these people were saying my lines from some of the movies,
right.
and I said, oh my God.
Yeah.
27
Iconic.
Years. Yeah, 25 years ago, people, I mean, I had no idea. I was
right.
so appreciated, so it felt great.
That's great. And so, Jussie just been cleared of all charges,
mm-hmm.
and so what... did you have any feelings about that situation? Did you talk to him or anything during that whole...
Well,
situation he went through?
Well, first of all, it was his business.
Mm-hmm.
And I honestly say I love Jesse.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, my heart went out to him, and I never accused him.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to wait till what has just happened.
Yeah.
I supported him 100% because, you know, I didn't believe it.
Mm-hmm.
I believed what he said happened, because in this climate today, that is real. real.
Yeah.
If you go on Instagram, you can see how we're being, you know, things haven't changed in so many ways. Right. The racism is real.
Yeah.
So, but what I will say is I don't gossip.
Mm-hmm.
I know no one and I know nothing.
There you go.
And I don't participate, but I listen.
Yeah.
But I am relieved because African American men are always overcharged in cases like that. I mean, to have that many counts,
that was ridiculous.
Whether it happened or not, it was ridiculous.
Right.
And also Manafort, think of mm-hmm. the justice. You know, black men are always overcharged. I love my brothers, and I pray for them all the time, like I did Mandela, you know. But, like, Manafort only got what he did for, you know, it's really sad.
Yeah.
I'm relieved, I'm happy, and I knew it.
Yeah.
And I believe in him, and I'm grateful for the outcome.
Awesome. Will we see you on Empire moving forward on a little bit more? Or?
I don't know. I mean, you know, the way I went out, was kind of sad.
Yeah.
I was gonna say a little bit. I exploded on camera, but I don't know. I'm open. I love offers, and I'm ready for new challenges in the work.
Yeah.
And so I'm back, and I'm ready to make new things
happen. Back in town. And now, speaking of another offer, mm-hmm. the Bobby DeBarge story.
Yes.
So that role, how was that for you? And did you learn anything new about the family portraying them?
I did.
Yeah.
I had no idea. It was very difficult playing this role. I had to really dig deep and to try to understand. I don't want to give anything away.
Right.
But I didn't know who Ice Cube was when I did Boyz in the Hood.
Uh-huh.
You know, I wasn't into rap.
Right.
I didn't know a lot. But and the DeBarge, I was more into Phyllis Hyman and Anita Baker and to Regina Bell. You know, I was single and I wanted love, and these women sang songs and Luther Vandross. But the DeBarge, that music was great. I remember dancing to it and feeling it, but I didn't know their story.
Yeah.
But in doing so, I read a couple of scripts about what happened to these children, and it was really sad.
Mm-hmm.
I was fortunate enough as a child and throughout my entire career never to have been harmed in any way with molestation, never. My mom I was very sheltered and protected. My mom wouldn't let us go outside until she came home from work, and then we'd have to ask if we could go out. We'd have to play in the yard, and we didn't go into other people's homes, or we didn't spend the night at people's houses.
Mm-hmm.
My mom used to tell us things about what happened to these children. To the squeaky wheel gets the oil, so you have to tell. And sometimes people know who they can and cannot touch.
Yeah, definitely.
And I was one of those that you knew you could not touch. And even, you know, in the industry, the casting couch, they knew they cannot touch.
Right.
So I would lose jobs or wouldn't get a job because I don't go there.
Well, good for you. Stay on your ground.
No, it's just real.
Yeah,
I mean, I know
real.
Who I am,
right,
and I'm
exactly.
not there for anything but the work.
Right, exactly.
But now I'm learning how to network and make friends. Slap your head and go, stop that. Whatever.
Yeah, you have the Me Too movement.
Yo,
all that
it's
stuff.
So
it's
important.
Huge. Yeah,
it's so important. So anyone who has pictures of people threatening people, just know this. It's the Me Too movement, and I just think it's about time.
Right.
And men need to respect us women, and we need to respect ourselves. And let's just collaborate, do the work, and if we're interested, we'll let you know.
Exactly, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, that's awesome. Thank you. We're going to be closing up pretty soon, but before we go, I just want to ask you just a couple questions here.
Mm-hmm.
What profession other than your own would you like to participate in?
I guess I would go into producing.
Producing?
Yes,
nice.
Because there are a lot of things I would like to see that I haven't seen yet.
Mm-hmm.
Like a movie with a woman in The Weeknd. I love the fact that the camera's starting to follow like Taraji and Niecy Nash and following Kerry Washington. So there are a lot of ideas I have about roles and just simple things. But to produce is what I would like to do.
Nice.
Yeah.
And so what's one piece of advice you wish you had before coming to L.A.?
One piece of advice, don't talk too much. Listen more.
Listen, okay.
You know, I had to learn that. Mm. I had to learn that I was not the director, and my opinion really didn't matter sometimes, because I've been fired a couple of times from expressing myself.
Right.
But, and when I stopped doing that, I started feeling and listening and seeing more. So, you know, just listen, look, and learn.
Listen, look, and learn. Three L's.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Right? Well, yeah. I thank you so much for being here inside the Black Actors Studio. It was great to have you.
Thank you.
I enjoyed our conversation very much so. And I want to say thank you all for watching. Also, thank you to AfterBuzz, Black Hollywood Live, for allowing us to be here. Tyra, go ahead and tell everyone where to find you.
Oh, well, I'm at, my agency is KMR, and they're on the East Coast and the West Coast, and my management is Fidelity Management with Will Flaherty. Everyone needs a Will.
Everyone needs a Will. And how about social media?
And social media, I am at Tyra Ferrell, and that's my Instagram. That's all I am.
Yeah. New to Instagram, but
to
killing
Instagram.
It already.
Oh, really?
Yes,
okay.
Killing it already.
All right, thank you.
And you can find me everywhere at I Am Danny Royce. Thank you so much. We'll see you next week, same place, same time, here on Inside the Black Actors Studio.
Thank you.
Have a good one. Bye-bye.
On behalf of our BHL staff, we would like to thank you for tuning in to Black Hollywood Live, the world's first digital broadcast network devoted entirely to urban entertainment and pop culture. Check out our Black Hollywood Live YouTube page for even more great programming and amazing content. And be sure to subscribe and like our channel when you do. I'm your BHL host, Nakia Monet, and you can find me on all social media at Kiki Boom Boom or at Black Hollywood Live. Black Hollywood Live, Hollywood redefined.
And do not necessarily reflect the views of BHL or its owners or principals.